Are you using MQTT for your IoT devices? Well, yesterday I did something that I wish I'd done so much earlier. For many years I've been using Mosquitto. It's a great way to set up an MQTT broker. But my problem with Mosquitto has always been it's really, really hard to get Websockets up and running. So yesterday I took the plunge and had a look at HiveMQ, which is a MQTT broker that you may know of because you've probably used their guides. So they have a product called HiveMQ, and that is a MQTT broker, and it turns out it is not too hard to set it up. So let me walk you through the process. I'll be using DigitalOcean since that's what I use for all my personal projects. So let's just start. It doesn't take more than 10 minutes to set up a fully secured server using HiveMQ. So we'll start by creating a droplet. We'll use Ubuntu Basic, the cheapest option, $5 per month. We don't need anything else. I think Frankfurt is the closest to me since I'm in Norway. You'll need to add an SSH key here. I have one already set up. DigitalOcean have a good explanation of how you do that. We'd need just one droplet, and you just say create droplet, and off it goes. This thing counts up, and we'll just fast forward a bit here. So now we have our web server here. So let me just copy that into my login string and we'll open the terminal. So if you did everything correctly with regards to DigitalOcean, all you need to do is to press enter and you should go straight in once you type yes. And here we are. So now we're on the server. Let's move it like that. The first thing you want to do when you start your new server is to make sure that you have all the latest software available. So you just run sudo apt update. This takes a while. During the install, we'll also be needing unzip. So we'll install unzip using apt install unzip. Okay, now we have unzip installed. And the next thing we'll need is that we'll also need to install Java. HiveMQ is based on Java, so it needs the Java runtime to be on the host. So sudo apt install default JRE. Yes, we want to do that. It takes a while. So just have some more coffee. And there we are. So by now we should have everything we need. I'll be following partially this guide, which is in the repository. So HiveMQ comes in two versions, or three versions. It's two commercial versions and one community edition, and that is for free. That is, it is limited, but it has all the features you'll need for most MQTT setups. It's a really good server. It's very easy to get started. So yeah, I'll just let you follow along as I do this. So the first thing we want to do is to grab a copy of HiveMQ. I want to put it in the slash opt folder. So here we are, nothing there. And then we'll clone from the Git repository into this folder. We'll go into that folder, some tab to autocomplete, and then we'll start building this. This is using Gradle, which is a build system for Java that builds everything you need. Okay, and there we are. So what has happened now is that it made a folder called build, and inside that one there is a zip folder. So we'll go into that, and then we'll unzip HiveMQ, and this part will depend on your version number, so I'll just press tab and it will autocomplete. And here we are. So now the version that was built specifically for this platform is now unzipped in this folder. Next, we'll need to link this folder to the official HiveMQ directory. Let's go to so you can see it easier. So we'll link this to this folder, which is where we have the files, slash the unpacked folder. And then we're linking that to slash opt slash HiveMQ. So now if we go to slash opt slash HiveMQ, we now have a shortcut here. So if I do a nice LA, you can see that these are the files. We'll also need to have a user to run this as, and do it using this command, user add dash d slash opt HiveMQ and HiveMQ. And when you've done that, you also need to do an additional thing. You need to use the user mod to add HiveMQ to the sudo group, or else it won't be able to use the super user command, which is being used in the initd or systemd scripts to set this up to run automatically on startup. Then we need to make sure that the folders are being owned by the right user. So chown dash big R HiveMQ, HiveMQ, opt HiveMQ, and where you extracted all the files to. And then we'll need to do the same, but also for just slash opt HiveMQ like this. And when we've done that, we should just change the bash scripts which you're using to run the server. And at this point, we actually should be able to run it. So if we slash opt slash HiveMQ slash bin run sh. And this is how it looks when it starts up. You'll see that it brings up the server using standard things. Let's make this window a little wider. So to try this out, you'll need to use an MQTT client of some sort. This is what I'm using, MQTT Explorer on OS X. You'll find lots of other clients. You can use the command line clients in Mosquitto, anything you want actually. And you just enter the host name, and the host will be using MQTT protocol on port 1883, just as it says here. And no username and password, and we can just connect, and here we are. And we can post this to the server, and other clients would be able to get this. So that's how you get it up and running. But as you can see, we have a few things to solve. This is not secure, we'll have to secure it. But we also want to be able to connect from WebSockets. Well, let's start by WebSockets. Just Control C to cancel the server, just like I inadvertently did on startup. And then go to this page. So the manual here on the GitHub lists how to add different listeners. And if you look at this, this is the bit you need to add to the listener sections of the config file. Here you add the port number, the path, and all these things. So let's have a look at this. So if you list the files, you'll see that we have a bin folder, which is where we have our executable. We have a configuration folder, data, and extensions. So now we'll go into the configuration folder and edit the configuration file. I'll just do it from here. So config XML, pico config XML. And if you just scroll down here, you'll see the current configuration. We have the listeners, which is just TCP listener. So we just paste in the WebSocket listener here, close it, save, Control X to close, say yes, and you write it. And when we now restart the server, you'll see that it comes up with couple of or one more service. So you'll see it starts a WebSocket listener and it's on port 8000. You can change this as you like, but let's just disconnect here, and we can change this to be WebSockets. By default, it doesn't use WES, it uses MQTT as the base path, and the port number needs to be 8000. And now we're connected using a WebSocket, and yes, we can still publish data to the server. Okay, so now we have this server set up, but we need to, or we want to secure it. So start by doing that, Control C to stop the server. So as I mentioned, there is an extensions folder. So let's go into that one. And here you can see the default extension, which is allow all. So we'll just remove that using rm-r and delete it like that. And then we'll open a web page, which is this one, the rback extension. This is the security extension that gives basic authentication. So it has a download button. We'll just copy the link from that one. And then we'll use wget to pull that down. And as you can see, it's called HiveMQ-file-rback-extension-4.4. So yours might be different depending on when you're viewing this video. But as of just now, that's what it's called. You'll just want to use the latest one. And there it is. And we just want to unzip this. And then we want to remove the zip file. So now we have this folder, and it contains a configuration file and credentials. And let's have a look at the credentials. Pico. So here we have a user predefined, and it has a password of pass1, and it has a role called role1. This password here is something you generate using a built-in tool. I'll show you that. And here you have an admin user with an admin password, which I couldn't actually get to work. But that's fine. It doesn't really matter. So let's start by giving our user one. It can just keep its default settings, and then we'll just restart the server. And you'll see that when we're starting it now, it doesn't show this message about security. It's starting with file permissions. It has everything ready. We can use our client, and we'll now need to use user1 pass1, and we should be able to connect. We can, however, not post to this folder, and I'll show you why later. Now, actually, let's just close down the server. Okay, that took some time. So let's look at the credentials file again. And so let's say I want to change this default user to be my name, my nick, and I want to have a custom password. And I also want this to be a super user. So what role1 and superuser is, you'll find further down. So you'll see that role1 should only be able to write and subscribe to data, and then the client ID, and then the topic. You can also use the username in this replacement here. And same thing with output. And the superuser can do everything. So for now, it's easy to just do that. But we need a password. That's the thing. So how do we get the password? Well, in this folder, you have this jar file. And this jar file is what allows us to create the password. So we'll execute this using Java. And then we want to use -p and then our password. So we'll find something cryptic like this. And this will return this kind of lengthy thing here. I'll just copy it, and then I'll add that to my credentials file. Control X to close, save, yes, and then we'll restart the server. And now I can log in as my name with my lengthy password using WebSockets or TCP. And since I'm now a super user, I can publish to any topic as well. Okay, so now it's time to make this permanent. We have the service, we know it works. All we need to do now is to copy this example service into etc systemd system HiveMQ service, and then this command. And if we now do a sudo reboot, I'll lose the connection, but we can also reconnect after waiting a few seconds. So now that the server has restarted, we should be able to test if the service is running using this command, which says it's active and running. And then we should be able to connect and reconnect to it using TCP publish, disconnect using WebSockets, and then MQTT, save that. Oh, and right, it's port 8000. Like so. So there you have it. This is a guide for how to setting this up. Be advised that this guide applies to the version of Ubuntu that I used. If you have a different version of Ubuntu, you might need to use some slightly different commands, like Raspberry Pi and other versions may use initd. Ubuntu is now using systemd primarily. So follow the guide linked in the description below and you should be good to go. Have fun.